So we are in the, as we are in the last day of the conference, and one of the advantage of getting scheduled last in your first conference is that you can observe others. And I've been observing people talk, I've observed others talk like for two days. And I've made some last minute changes, and that even my advisor doesn't know. I bet I don't screw it up. But anyway, coming straight to the point, as an audience, my first question was, what's in it for me? So, which I think most of you have in your mind right now. So I'd like to answer that by making you think that at some point of time, you must have dealt with some biological analysis pipeline. Now, if any part of your pipeline tries to solve the problem of read alignment, and it follows a special structure. So there is a big asterisk over special structure, so which I'm going to talk about in the coming slides. Then this talk can help you reduce your running time dramatically and with improved accuracy. So before moving further, let me briefly define the problem of read alignment. So the problem of read alignment can be defined as follows. If you are given with some set of read, shown here by capital R, and a reference sequence shown here by capital T, and also a distance function D, which gives distance between two sequences U and V, and epsilon, which denotes maximum allowable edit distance, then what you have to find is you have to find alignment for every read in the reference sequence. So it's pretty intuitive, and it's pretty well-known problem. So now the problem of read alignment is very well studied, and the root goes back to Smith-Waterman algorithm. And so before moving further, I would like to add a disclaimer here. So the problem has been very well studied, and there are a plethora of tools available here, which with a lot of brilliant work. I mean, if you see the paper by Myers and his group, and then the suite of tool by Hengli, like MEQ, BWA, BWAMM, and there was a tool by Ben Langmead and his group called Bowtie and Bowtie 2, and they just keep on coming. So the natural question comes to my mind is, why do we need another one? And if sometimes people answer it by saying that we need faster tool, but why do we still have the need for speed? So turns out a recent study done by Moore et al. Shows that short read archive of NCBI has more than 4 petabytes of data, and which is increasing exponentially. And the real cost of sequencing will be dominated by computational part instead of physical sequencing itself. So what we are vouching here for is the term called analysis efficient computation, by which we mean performing only the necessary computation required for specific analysis of interest. So that's what we have shown in our paper for quantification pipeline, but other tools like Boiler by Pritt and Langmead uses the similar concept for logic compression of quality scores. So coming back to the problem of read alignment, let's talk about which I'm not gonna talk about, since the problem of read alignment has lots of variation. So, and basically I'm working on NGS data. Specifically in NGS, I'm working on RNA sequencing. Now, if you see RNA sequencing, there are two ways in which you can broadly divide the problem of read alignment. So the first one is splice alignment, where you align RNA-seq reads directly to the genome. And if you align RNA-seq reads to the genome, you would face challenges like exon boundaries, splice junction, which tools like top hat and or high set salt. So the second type of alignment which I am going to concentrate on this talk about is transcriptome alignment, where you align RNA-seq reads to the transcriptome. So the real motivation for us to concentrate on transcriptome alignment was because you can use in both the reference and the de novo word. But there's a huge challenge of multi-mapping rate, which we see because of the alternative splicing and many more biological reasons, which tools like Bowtie solves in previously. So now in transcriptome alignment, we again have two major divisions. This particular division is very important because the community uses these words interchangeably. Like, we have read aligners. They are just like normal aligners. What they find is nucleotide to nucleotide correspondence between read and the reference. And then we have read mappers. So what are read mappers? They are just like aligners, but with no cigar strings. What cigar string is like just in the SAM format, we have nucleotide to nucleotide correspondence, which is represented by small string. So we don't worry about that in read mappers. So it's a little counterintuitive right now, but as the coming slides will, as the slides will come, it will get more clarified. So with this view, we have developed a tool called RapMap, which is short of Rapid Mapper. Sorry for that. So we have a tool called RapMap, which is short of Rapid Mapper, which is available on GitHub under the banner Combine Lab. So our tool RapMap uses the concept of quasi mapping. So what is quasi mapping? It's just a tuple of transcript, position, and orientation. So we will talk more about this in the coming slides. So before moving further, let me give you some intuition of the words which we are using in our quasi mapping technique, quasi mapping concept. So if I give you a transcriptome shown on the left by if I give you a transcriptome shown in the left, and each row represents transcript, where each color in one transcript represents an exonic region. And if I give you a read, like shown on the right, let's assume it's of orange color, and I want to ask you a question here, where would this read map to in this transcriptome? Obviously to all of them, but if I take a read which is coming from two exonic regions, like here it is shown with orange and green, so what do you think where it will map to? Obviously to the third transcript. But the problem is, the real problem is to find how fast can we really find this read is coming from this specific region, this specific transcript. So before moving further, let me explain you the idea of NIP, which is called as next informative position. So if you parse the read from left to right, then you will map it to all the transcript in the transcriptome, and that's good, denoted here by region A to B in the transcriptome. But as soon as you have sufficient information that a read is coming from some set of transcript, the information can be redundant until some divergence. So what I mean is, once you have seen that read is coming from these set of transcript in region A to B, then the region between B to C is just redundant. You are not getting any new information. So what you can do is you can just skip from B to C. And this C position we are calling, it is called as next informative position. So we have formally defined the notion of NIP, next informative position, in our paper. And we have also noted that a related idea of k-mer skipping is used in Callisto. They share similar motivation, but there are significant differences in terms of practical results and implementation. So moving further, like all intelligent tools for read alignment, to get quasi mapping, we make the index on the reference. So note here, you need to make the index on the reference only once, based on the sample. And once we have our transcriptome, we just concatenate them all together using some separator, which is here shown by dollar sign. Now, in the next step, we just build plain old suffix array out of this reference. And the second data structure which we use is just an hash table which maps every k-mer in the reference sequence to its suffix array interval. Like example shows like ATTGA, which is a 5-mer coming from suffix array interval 14 to 16. It's an open interval, so it's actually between 14 to 16. Now, the third data structure which we have used is rank structure. What it tells you, it's which position in the reference sequence, a specific position, which transcript a position in the reference sequence is coming from. Like in the example, 1204th position in the transcriptome is from transcript T5. So that's what we need as indexing. And now coming to the mapping part, I like to show this with a toy example. And let's say we have indexed the reference already, and we have to find a quasi mapping for the read with, say, k-mer length of 3. Now, as we have hash table H, then we can directly get the suffix array interval for k-mer ATT shown here by B to E. So if you try to match ATT, then using hash table H, we can just get the interval B to E in constant time. So once we have this interval, it becomes our interval of interest. And for the next phase of the algorithm, we just need to concentrate in this region, this interval of the suffix array. So what we do next, we just extend our match by one base. which has been denoted here by blue box, and find the subinterval inside that, which is again has been shown by a blue box in the suffix array. So we keep on extending this match by making our we keep on extending the match by finding subinterval inside our interval of interest until we get a red box which denotes here a mismatch. So here we could have skipped till this blue box and call it a day, but since the example is trivial, there are a lot of exceptions which can happen here. So let's assume a read of 200 base pair, and we have exact match of 70 base pair. Then it is quite possible the next mismatch is because of sequencing error or a variation. So assuming if that error has not been occurred, then the informative position which reduces the search space, that is NIP, is defined by the longest common extension of the interval of interest in the suffix array, which is shown here by the red region. So the whole crux of doing this thing is to find next informative position, maximum exact match, by skipping as much as we can. So once we have this, once we have the exact matches as shown here by the blue box in the read, quasi mapping reports the map transcripts, its orientation, and the position. So this phase is very important in a sense. We are taking consensus by intersecting the set of these tuple with consistent orientation. So like shown in the example here, green and red brings the distinction of the orientation, but you can imagine all sorts of things like the blue region should be 60% or 80% of the whole read. So the important information which wrap map and quasi mapping brings to the table is the position and orientation information. Because wrap map gets mapping directly from position information, it is very easy to enforce additional information like collinearity because of the orientation information, which is available optionally already in wrap map. So now, as we have understood the underlying concept of the tool, I'd like to show our results, which I'm very excited about. So first, let me show you the results for. Sorry. So first let me show you the results for simulated data. Now we have simulated data using Flux Simulator, and configuration can be found in the paper. So we have simulated 76 base pairs, 75 million paired end reads, and mapped them to the human transcriptome. So we have compared three tools, Bowtie 2, Star, and WrapMap. We have compared actually four tools. I've just missed the Callisto here. And since Callisto does not have an independent implementation of pseudo mapping, so we were not able to map this timing result for Callisto. So here's the graph. Looks like mind the y-axis, which has been clipped since the difference was too big to plot. Also, I would like to say that we don't want to condescend any tool in a sense that all the tools have been developed with different motivation. And to make the comparison fair, we have to adjust their parameters to work with specific data which we are working on. Again, detail can be found online in the paper. If you see the rightmost part of the plot, it shows WrapMap maps a simulated data in 2 minutes, Star does in 14, and Bowtie takes little too long to finish. So now the interesting part of the plot is the red dotted line which represent index loading time. Now, if you see close enough, then what's happening is WrapMap is getting I/O bounded and using most of the time in loading the index, or in other words, 75 million reads is way too less. So to make the comparison fair, we reduce the number of threads for Star and WrapMap, and you can see the difference is clearly visible. So Callisto doesn't appear in this graph because of the limitation of the software that prevented fair comparison in this context. So more details are in the paper, but in single-threaded comparison, results were similar to WrapMap, but WrapMap being slightly faster. So with this slide, WrapMap looks pretty good, but the next question, obviously, how accurate is this? So we have used the same set of tools for accuracy of the comparison, but with 48 million reads. In this metric, almost all tools look pretty good, but if I would like to put Bowtie 2 and WrapMap in one tuple and Star and Callisto in another one, because based on the number for F1 score and number of read aligns, And so what you want to see, the next important thing here is hits per read, which usually represent number of multi-mapping reported by an aligner for each read. This number should be as low as possible to achieve good F1 score. Now, if you see Bowtie 2, it has good F1 score, but it is reporting more multi-mapping than other methods. If you see Start, it has the fewest multi-mapping, but a lower F1 score. So that thing needs to be distinct. So the next sets of the results are really tricky in a sense. For real data, we don't know the truth. So all we can check is the concordance of two tools. So we have done this using tuple of read and the set of transcript, and if two tools are concordant, if this tuple is exactly the same. So here I'm showing is 2x2 comparison of tool, and x-axis represent the two compared method. So if you see the yellow region, it is the comparison of two aligners. And if you see the green region, then we have comparison of aligner and mapper. So the important thing is comparison of aligner mapper is almost as similar as the comparison of two aligners. This is 2x2. You can always view the whole set of comparison, but it is pretty dense for the talk. And I would like to conclude by saying that RapMap is an ultra-fast tool, and it is highly accurate, and it's available under GPL license. And we have retrofitted RapMap with two pipelines. With quasi-selfish, we try to improve with the accuracy of selfish, and we have another method called as RapClass, which is used for de novo clustering. And it resulted in one more paper, which is available at ReCom-Seq. So I would like to end it by saying that I started with a question. I want to end by a question. Where are you going to use it? So at the end, I would like to thank my fellowship helpers, Stony Brook University, ISCB. These are some references. And we are available at GitHub, Twitter. Sorry for that. I'm open to questions now.